Hello, my name is Paige, and I go to Jeanette City School District.
And I'm Toby Neufeld, a child of survivors. Both of my parents were survivors from Poland.
What was your parents' life like before it was interrupted by the war and the Shoah?
I don't know too much about their lives. They didn't talk a whole lot, but both my parents were married, not to each other, and they had children. My mother had one daughter. My father had two daughters. He worked, he was a shoemaker, but he made the top of shoes, the leather part of the shoes. And my mother, I believe, was a homemaker. And she also helped her mother, who was not a well person, and I believe she helped her in-laws. That's all I really know.
Did your parents share with you what it was like when they were teenagers?
Not very much. My father was apprenticed early, so he worked and helped out the family. My mother helped her family. Her father died when she was 10, and so she took over her father's job, which was a mailman. So she would walk through the town and go through to the farms and help the farmers deliver mail, and not only deliver mail, but read letters and write letters for them. I don't know how much of a childhood or a teenage years they actually had. They didn't talk too much about it.
What do you think the war changed about your parents?
Oh my goodness. Well, first of all, it wiped out their families. My father had one brother that survived out of parents and six sisters, four of whom were married with children. One was engaged and one was 15 years old. So that was one major thing. And of course he lost his wife and two children. And my mother lost her husband and her child. And she had one sister that did not survive the war. She has two brothers that did survive the war. And many aunts and uncles on both sides. So of course that changed their life in every way. What else can I tell you? I think their personalities changed quite a bit. I know that my uncle used to say that my mother's personality had changed a lot. Before, she was much more confident and much more self-assured. And after the war, she was very anxious and nervous about things. So that's one thing. I don't know about my father. I think my father was a little more happy-go-lucky before the war. But they lived in a very small town, so I don't know how happy-go-lucky he could be.
What was stolen from your family during the Shoah?
Basically, their family life. They were very poor, and so they did not have anything physical to steal from them. Nothing in their homes that was worth anything, except whatever artifacts they had for the holidays. So it was basically the family and their life, their lifestyle.
What lessons do you think your parents would want to impart to young people today?
That's a good question. I think they would want people to be strong, to be able to be able to survive things that seem difficult to them and not give up. They would want youngsters, teenagers, even younger, and certainly young adults, to be able to live their life no matter what, because their life as they knew it was taken away from them. And when they came to the United States and started all over again with a home and a family and work. And so I think persistence would be part of it as well. And they would want you to speak up, not to just accept whatever is given to you blindly, but to fight for what you think is right.
The Holocaust Center in Pittsburgh has been around for 40 years. What role has the center had on your life and your family's lives?
Oh, for my family, first it was they were not in Pittsburgh. They didn't move to Pittsburgh until their much later life, and then they would attend the functions they could at the Holocaust Center. For me, I've been active in the Holocaust Center since it first started, so I've had quite a bit to do with it. I've been on different committees, attended many things. We had an organization that we call the Legacy, that were children of Holocaust survivors, that would meet and talk. We had a group that met with survivors as well, and that was very helpful. I've been part of the Yom HaShoah program for, I don't know, almost since its inception. So I've really had quite a bit to do with the Holocaust Center. Plus, I've made additional friends that way. So it's been pretty good, pretty important for me.
Is there anything else you would like to share with us about your family's Holocaust experience or story that you've not already told us about?
They were both in concentration camps. They were not in the camps that most people think of the six death camps, like Auschwitz and Sobibor and all those. However, they were in work camps and they had very, very difficult lives. Lots of different things happened to them during the war. After the war, well, when they were liberated well, that's not quite right. They were on a death march at the end as the armies were coming closer to Poland to liberate the camps. And they were on this death march and they escaped from the death march. My mother told my father that she was going to run away because she knew the countryside. They were never very far from their hometown of Krasnik. And she told him he could come or not because he said they're going to shoot us if we run. She said they're going to shoot us anyway. Or we just won't survive. I'd rather take my chances running. And they did. And she knew where to run and where to hide. And when they arrived at their hometown, because everyone went home to see if they could find any survivors, they were told to leave the town because they survived and the people didn't want them there anymore, even though their families had been there for several hundred years. And they walked from Poland to Italy. And they were in a DP camp in Italy, in North Italy, Cremona, which is east of Milan, and I was born there. Also, my parents had grown up together. My father was my mother's uncle's best friend, and so he knew her all her life, and of course knew everything about each other. When they found themselves in the last camp on the death march, that's when they left together, and they wound up getting married. They knew their spouses were gone and their children were gone. And so we went to a DP, they were in a DP camp and we lived there until 1949 and then came to the United States in December 1949. And they started all over. They had to get an apartment and jobs and start raising a family. And I have a brother who was born 5 years after I was. I can't think of anything else. If there's something that you could think of you'd like to ask, please do.
Is there anyone for whom you light this candle? If so, tell us a little bit about this person.
I'm going to light the candle for my family that was killed. Of course, I did not get to know my family other than my parents and three uncles. I was named after my grandmother. And I just would like to remember everyone, my grandparents, my aunts, my uncles, my cousins, my half siblings that did not survive. And so I'm going to light this candle in their memory. Thank you. Anything else?
You made it seem like this was a harsh topic for your parents. Do you think, if they were still here, would you ask them any questions, that they didn't, it was like a harsh topic, so they didn't want to talk about it, but you wish you would have said this before they passed?
Yes, there were many questions I have now that I could have asked them, but it was very, very difficult to ask questions. They would get very upset. My mother would answer more questions. My father answered some, but they never went into any real details, just a few things that happened to them. Not minor things, major things, but they didn't want to tell me any of the horrors or the terrible times they had, because they didn't want me to be upset and hurt about their experiences. So they didn't tell me as many things as I would like to know, which I regret, such as what was their life like as a teenager. I don't know any of that. When I tried in the later years, they couldn't speak. Both my parents had Alzheimer's. My mother's very severe, actually was more dementia. And I couldn't ask them any questions because they couldn't answer them anymore. So I have lots of regrets about that. But at the same time, I understand the reasoning for it.
We recently in class learned about Irene, and she was someone who actually survived, and she was actually in the camps, and she was like one of the people who got to be in the trial of a Nazi person who was actually collected the funds, but they didn't kill any people, but she was there. And one of the questions that someone asked her was, if you were to talk to someone, would you accept them? Like, would you show empathy for them? Like, would you, if you were to talk to a Nazi guard, would you, like, almost not be mad? Like, you understand what I'm trying to come across?
I do. Now, are you asking about me or my parents?
You.
Me. I don't think I would be very warm to someone like that. Having said that, I don't feel the same way about people that are younger that are German. I don't blame the children of the people that were Nazis doing anything, supporting all the terrible things that happened to the Jewish people. Their children are not to blame. So I don't have a problem with them, but I would be very uncomfortable with someone who was actually there and was part of the atrocities in some way, regardless of what they did.
If you were to describe the Holocaust in three words, what would those three words be?
Three words. Unreasonable, hateful, murder.
No, I don't really think I have any more questions. But thank you for answering anything and for talking to me.
Thank you. Bye.